And welcome to your Raider show on RTV. And boy, do we have a show for you today. We won't have enough time to say and to do everything we want to do. But I know, see that smile? I know you didn't have that since Thursday night at about 10 o'clock.
It was so good to finally get back in the win column. I mean, the Raiders, we had a four-game losing streak, and that hasn't happened since Al Davis in 1963. So I think that one of the great things about this game is that, you know, the monkey's off our back.
Well, all I can say is that we talked about extensively last show about vertical football. That's the only reason we won. We didn't have a choice but to be vertical. But what it did, it opened up the running game and opened up the short passes.
You're absolutely right. And it's crazy that the Raiders, you know, for the first six games of the season, the Raiders were a different team. And there's a reason. During the offseason, the Raiders picked up some key players just to beat Kansas City. Jared Cook, the tight end. Derek Carr needed a weapon. Derek Carr was the one that was able to negotiate the deal to bring Jared Cook to the Raiders. And some of the plays that we called, the vertical passing game, we hadn't done any play-action passes. We did six play-action passes the whole first six games of the season. We did seven play-action passes
in one game.
So there's plays that we left on the playbook that we didn't want nobody to see on tape. And then the reason why is we didn't want Kansas City to have game film to plan for. So I have to give kudos to the coaching staff, because the coaching staff was the ones that were able to bring the Raiders and have them prepared to play.
Well, let's talk about my specialty. Well, no, let me clarify that. You know my specialty is number seven.
I know.
But second specialty is the offensive line. I think they might be back into sync again. I'm not saying they out of the woods yet. I mean, they played very well in the second half of that game. But I hope this is something that's going to lead so the remainder of the season will be that strong, best offensive line in the league that they should be.
Well, I think now that the playbook is finally open and we're letting people know what we're doing, I think you will see improved offensive line play. And one of the reasons why you're going to see improved offensive line play is because now they're in sync. It's almost like midseason form. You know, when you're a big guy over 325 pounds, there's a thin line between being big and overweight and being big and in shape. And I think the first few games of the season, plus the absence of Donald Penn in the preseason, caused the Raiders to be, other selfish acts to talk about. But I do think that that's why you're seeing an improvement in the offensive line.
See, and they talk about, you know, the preseason is not worth this, not worth that. You know, I've heard so many people say colleges don't have preseason. Hey, this is not college football.
They play so well that Derek Carr was 29 for 52, not 300 yards, but 417 yards, three touchdowns, and no interceptions. He wasn't touched. Well, he was touched once, but we'll talk about that again later on.
That's the selfish part.
Yeah, that's the thing. But, you know, more impressive was the play of the forgotten man, Amari Cooper, the forgotten man.
Hey.
He was able to have 19 targets. Another change in the Raiders' philosophy for the game. They were trying to get him the ball early. They succeeded in getting him the ball early. And, I mean, watching him streak down the sideline reminded me of Warren Wells streaking down the sideline of Cliff Branch, hauling in that bomb that was thrown by Derek Carr. A beautiful 38-yard pass, right? And then crossing the field kind of takes me back to how Jerry Rice or John Taylor from the other side of the bay used to catch them slants and turn it all the way up the field for another 47-yard touchdown. So Amari finished the night with 11 catches for 210 yards and two touchdowns. A great comeback for Amari Cooper.
But, you know, and with that being said, and I was so happy because I interviewed him several times when we were doing it back at the Chicken and Waffles, but he's a nice kid. He's still a kid, but he's still a nice young man. And I felt so bad for him because he was struggling, but people didn't understand. It wasn't really him struggling. It was the system that they were playing at the time that didn't allow him to do. That game against Kansas City showed if you allow him to do his thing out there, he's going to catch the ball.
Absolutely.
But he's not. And I don't say this to diminish his abilities by any means, but his bread and butter is going long.
Absolutely. And but, Carr throws a great deep ball.
Right.
He puts a lot of air up under it to allow you to be able to run underneath the ball. But I think also was important, obviously, was the other play on the other side. Because Michael Crabtree.
Well, that's what I was coming to. But that's what I was coming to.
Mm-hmm.
And so when you talk about those first six games and you talk about most of his passes were short passes and he got to the point where he had the dropsies, because that's not the way. Even at Alabama, he didn't play like that. He always extended the defense, and then you make him go through this other stuff. I didn't get that. I new offense coordinator, whatever you want to say, I just didn't get it. But, you know, we can't go back and change what didn't happen, right?
I think the leash has been taken off.
I think
you see the 2017 Oakland Raiders, if it ain't broke, don't fix it. Until you can stop the vertical game.
Got to throw it.
We got to throw the ball downfield. If nothing more, just to stretch the defense to allow some of the underneath
stuff. That's what we talked about last week before they even did it.
Absolutely.
And see, and you go back to Crabtree. It makes him even more effective.
And Seth Roberts.
Yes. Well, right. Seth Roberts has, I mean, he's struggling. And see, and this is what, you know, remember the one play over the middle? And when you see it on the regular play, you can't tell. But then on the replay, he's running this way and he has to reach back across his body. This is Carr's pass.
Right.
It wasn't there. But good players make those plays.
Right. And I don't.
It wasn't like it was way. All he had to do was reach back, number one, focus on the ball first. I think he was kind of focusing on who was coming, get the ball. You know, I was a wide receiver. So
alligator arm.
Exactly. That's right. What I'm talking about. So, you know, you're playing a professional sport. That's a vicious sport. It is what it is. But mm-hmm. As a receiver, you have a sense. You know where the defense is coming.
Right.
You know, and you, especially if you run a route and you know where the defense is playing. When you go out, whether they're in a zone, whether they're in a man-to-man, you know what I'm saying? More so in a zone because people are in their spots. But in man-to-man, it's a whole different mentality. But you know where they are. And that one, I thought he the alligator arms got even.
He did.
He had like a frog arm because he
didn't
want it.
For those of you who don't know what alligator arms is, it's when you're coming across the middle, you outstretch to catch the ball, but you know you're about to get hit, so you don't want to put your arms out there in order to catch it.
Open up them ribs.
Exactly.
Take us out.
Yeah, okay. Well, yeah, Jay Cutler got some rib damage too this week, but we're not going to have any damage by getting sued by some of our sponsors. We're going to go give them some time, and we'll be right back with more of your Raider show here on our TV.
Bob Melvin's an Oakland guy. People love him. In fact, I think he could be mayor one day.
Mr. Mayor, the police commissioner is out sick.
Okay, thanks. Get the lefty up.
Will do, Mayor.
And welcome back to your Raider show on our TV. And we have, you guys should be in here doing our break. One time they got to have somebody film while Matt's getting everything set up because they don't know all the stuff we talk about in between. but I'm going to let you finish your point. So we go back. We were talking about Crabtree, but then you threw some things in there that I think they need to hear.
Well, I think, you know, Crabtree has been Crabtree. Right now he has seven touchdowns already. Near the halfway point. But I think what we really need to look at is what's inside the Raiders right now. What was their mentality? Where's their heart at? And they proved that. They first got the ball back. It was like 5 minutes left in the game. You're thinking, okay, they went 3-and-out. You're like, oh, okay, where are they heart at, right? Fortunately for us, the defense stepped up and forced the 3-and-out. And it ended with a great sack by Khalil Mack. And that's the way you want to see a defense close out when a team has to take time off the clock and they're trying to extend it so that you don't get an opportunity. Khalil Mack came and he closed it. He was met. They sandwiched Alex Smith for the only time of the night, the only sack of the game, and then that gave us the ball back. So this is where it gets exciting, ladies and gentlemen, because, you know, we got the ball back with 2 minutes and 25 seconds on the 15-yard line. An 85-yard drive is needed. So what did Derek Carr do? Is he going to rise to the challenge? Is the offensive line going to step up? Well, this is what Derek Carr did. So the first thing he did is he hit Amari Cooper to get everything just like we got it started in the game. Hit him, and then what really saved us was on a 3rd and 20, he hit Amari Cooper over the middle, and that extended the drive. So what did he do next? So Derek Carr, mixing it up and everything, he was able to find, first he found Jared Cook on the 1-yard line, and we were up. We were up 30-30, getting ready to go for one. And everybody thought the game was over at that time. All we need was Giorgio to come through and kick the ball. But the replay showed that his butt hit the one-yard line, and he was down at the one-yard line in a very precarious position, because when they go to the replay booth and you don't have any time left on the clock, it's an automatic roll 10 seconds off the clock. He caught the ball with 16 seconds left. So in theory, they were going to roll it down to the 6-second mark. They rolled it up to the 8. The Raiders had the presence of mind to know that there was going to be a 10-second roll-off. So what do? They have a play call. So Derek Carr from the 1-yard line, he steps back, he looks, he fires to the right, Crabtree, touchdown. So that's two times we thought the game was over, but no, there's a flag on the play. And they said that he pushed off.
They said.
But there's a difference from pushing off. You know, as a wide receiver.
That's right.
I see your calves. I know you used to play ball somewhere. You know, as a wide receiver, that it's a difference from disengaging to get off me so I can turn around and catch, and pushing off in order to catch the ball. In my opinion, he disengaged.
Right. His arms didn't extend.
Exactly.
They did not extend. That's right.
You know the rules.
Exactly.
So I'm like, okay, here we go again with this Raider, haters that these officials just don't want us to win. So they move the ball back. So they move it to the 11-yard line. So now what is Carr going to do, right? There's absolutely no time left on the clock. So he goes right over the middle to Jared Cook, a little high, but he was being held by the safety. So another flag comes in. They're like, here we go again. We thought the game could have very well been over. So the next play, he goes, and then he fires again to a Cordell Patterson in the back of the end zone. Right? Well, is he out of bounds? No, here comes another flag. And so now they move the ball back to
Matthew's
the original
going nuts
position
at this point.
To the 1-yard line. Well, Matthew's got all this footage, so I know as I'm talking, you guys are seeing it. So we move the ball back to the 1-yard line. No clock, no time left on the clock. You know, if you look at this play, you will see a smile on Derek Carr's face, because him and Crabtree have
practiced
all the time in practice. But the thing is, they practiced it to the right side of the field. This time, Derek Carr, a right-handed quarterback, rolls out to the left side. And if you look at his face when he sees Crabtree on that comeback route that he did right near the pylon, he fires it in there.
And
Crabtree
it was the trajectory
catches it
of
down.
It. Yep, that's what I was going to say.
Look at me, y'all. He catches it like this and rolls to the side, and then we finally tie it up, and Giorgio comes through and barely gets it through the upright.
Didn't he?
And we win the game 31-30. That probably was one of the most amazing comebacks that I have witnessed since the time when I used to be at the Coliseum with my dad, very small, when I was there at the Sea of Hands catch, right? I was right there when Stabler rolled to that same area, that
and
same
Clarence
north end zone that he rolled to, that a Carr rolled to, Stabler, that's where he hit Clarence Davis in between Vin Benden Herter and then the two other safeties, Donnie Anderson and Jake Scott of the Miami Dolphins.
That's right.
And Clarence Davis, the worst hands on the Raiders team, was able to catch that ball in.
And he had it up here, too.
Yep,
and pulled it in,
and we won another amazing comeback. So that was for the Raider lore. Those of you that go that far back, I hope I took you back. And for the Raiders of the 2017, that unleashed us, and we're ready to go now.
Well, I tell you
ready to go.
The only other one that I remember that was so funny, because, I tell you, I had such a relationship with the players back then when I was with Nike. And I'd probably have 30 tickets to the game from the players. And Al would always give me
probably gave him 30 pairs of shoes, because he used to give us all shoes.
I get the players, but Al wouldn't take none. Mm-hmm. He said, just take care of my guys. He said, anything you need, let me know, but you take care of my guys. But the Heidi game, remember that?
There.
But I'm just saying, nobody in America saw it. If you wasn't in the Coliseum, you didn't see it, because they left us and went to Heidi because they thought the game was over. Mm-hmm. But anyway, we don't need to waste time on that. But the bottom line is, I believe now that they feel, we have done what nobody expected us to do, because Kansas City had one loss, right?
Correct.
And now they got two. They didn't expect to have the one loss, but now they got two. So then San Diego wins. So, I mean, we got a log jam, and then Denver got spanked.
Right, and Kansas City played Denver this week.
Oh, they all got to play each other.
So we're going to rise. Yeah. Right, they're going to knock each other off. So we are only right now as we speak, since Kansas City, we beat them, technically we're 1.5 games out of first place. You know, they have a 2-game lead, but we got a half game lead on them because we beat them in head-to-head competition. So we're looking pretty good right now. We just got to stack some wins.
Okay, you said 1 game out, let's take us out.
Yeah, exactly. Okay, so we're going to come back with what we got to do next. And we haven't forgot about the defense. The Raiders had a brand new player we're going to feature in our next segment of your Raiders show here on our TV.
These guys work hard at keeping their edge, and they find it in the most surprising places.
You're out, CJ. Not today, Jackie. Not on my watch, Spencer.
I don't think so, Billy.
You're out, Jimmy. Not today, Susie.
Nice try, Holly.
Booyah!
You never know where you're going to find that edge.
And welcome back to your, your Raider show on RTV. I started to say RTV on Raider show. Anyway, when you feel like I feel now about, I get excited because I want to see the true Raider team that I thought we were going to after the first couple of wins, even though we weren't playing great football. But I just figured that would carry over. And honestly, we should be 6-2 right now, I think, personally.
Agreed.
But it is what it is. But to be where we are, where we're in 6-2, I forgot we played 7 games. But the whole point is we're in a position, like you said, only a game and a half out realistically. But let's talk about the defense and what they brought to the table that, let's face it, nobody expected the way we've been playing.
Well, I think one of the things that really I was impressed with, and we should have been doing it, is, you know, Bruce Irvin, he was laying the wood to Kelce every time he came across the middle.
Popped him several
times. And all that did was disrupt their timing. Now, granted, he did score one touchdown, and he did extend a couple of drives. I mean, he's Travis Kelce. He's a great tight end,
He is.
Right? But he was getting his clock clean, and he was looking around for the ref like, what's going on?
Within five yards is legal.
Oh, you saw that one
too,
right?
Yeah, put him on his behind, and he's looking doing this.
Right. So I think there was a more aggressive approach. The obvious, Khalil Mack is Khalil Mack. He didn't have a lot of sacks, but he had a lot of pressures. And what the Raiders did, again, back to the coaching, again, this is one of the first times I've ever seen Andy Reid get out-coached on both sides of the ball. They were threatening the blitz. The last couple of weeks, the Raiders had blitzed a lot. This week, they threatened the blitz, which forced the double teams to switch to the inside to pick up the would-be blitzer, but it freed up Khalil Mack to have one-on-ones. And you saw him throw Eric Fisher on his behind with one hand too, didn't you?
Yes.
And then he also pushed him back with two hands coming from the other side. So when that locomotive get going, Khalil Mack, there's just no stopping him. So I think that they did well, but I think the biggest thing that you want to discuss, and I do too, is the emergence of our new player in our defense, Navarro Bowman.
All I can say is thank you, 49ers, second time. You know, the first one I thought was just a gift from heaven when we get Crabtree. You let him go to us. But then, seriously, I mean, he gets cut on one day and the next day he signed with the Raiders. Are you serious?
Yeah, that was crazy.
When I said, you know, they cut him. And the first thing, this is the God's truth. Before anything was said, I said, oh, man, could we use him? And then that night on the news, they talking to the Raiders. I'm like, oh, Lord, please let him come sign with us. Next day, done deal.
Yeah, it was only natural. I mean, he doesn't have to uproot his family, move anywhere else. We in a need right now. We had
big
linebackers. We talked about this last week on the show, that he would be a perfect fit for us.
And he did.
And actually,
he did fit very well.
Absolutely. He led the Raiders in tackles. You know, again, one of the times that we actually did blitz, he came up the gut and crashed Alex Smith right in the rib cage, which made him think and made him get rid of it early, and that was a turnover in downs, and we got the ball back. So he definitely was an impact. I saw a stop for a 1-yard loss behind the line of scrimmage. I saw him try to play the corners from left to right, sideline to sideline. So I was very impressed with him being able to step in, more importantly, to have that green dot placed on his helmet. The Raiders allowed him to control the defense alignment, and they were signaling plays to him. So for him to be able to do that, not only gave us another level of leadership, But that's going to take us because he's a hunting dog.
Oh, yeah.
He's
yeah.
coming downhill.
He's like a shark in bloody water.
Absolutely.
Well, let's at least talk about, you know, I didn't want to even talk about it, but, you know, I've known Marshawn for a long time. And I have a great deal of respect for him as a football player. But I just didn't quite understand, you know, Matthew and I were talking about this, you know, when we first came in studio. What is going to happen to your cousin? Nothing. He got on a helmet. He got on pads. I mean, they're going to push and shove. But have you ever seen a guy really get hurt in a brawl on the field? Very seldom does that ever happen. Maybe get a scratch or something. Well, what are they going to do? Punch through a helmet? Break your hand? But I thought, you know, come on, man. I mean, that definitely should be a come on, man. And I hope I'm talking about our safety from here that does it now.
Sean Smith?
No. On TV.
You're talking about come on, man.
Yeah.
I don't watch the other sports channels. I just watch our TV.
No, I watch them all.
I'm lying.
But I just hope that they do that just to show that this is so unnecessary. And the only thing that bothers me about it, and I know as an athlete, you know, you get steamed. I mean, I've done things. I go back and say, well, maybe I shouldn't have did that. I've done that myself. But my point is this. You have to look ahead at where you are. You're 3-4. He would be very much missed if he doesn't play Sunday in Buffalo.
Had we lost that game, everybody would have been blaming him because he wasn't there in the rest of the game when we needed him.
Right.
So, but
he's going back to Buffalo where he started. I mean, just as an athlete, you don't get up for that.
Right.
And now he may not be able to play. It's not done yet.
No, it is.
Because he's appealing, so hopefully it'll...
The appeal, they denied his appeal.
Oh, they did?
Yeah, they announced it this afternoon. I heard it on my way to the studio.
So he's out.
He's out. Right.
Well, and that's unfortunate because that's going to hurt his team.
Well, you know, I'm glad you brought that up because I feel as if that he's done some good things for us and he's done some things that, let's say, aren't so good for us. Certainly, leaving the sideline when you weren't even in the last two series, you weren't even in the play, you got to trust that the referees can manage the game and you don't have to intervene. I understand you're trying to save your cousin, or some people think you were trying to save your quarterback. Well, maybe you had both in mind. You just want to be a peacemaker. But there's guidelines. You know, there's coaches. You know, there's other people that are out there on the floor just trying to mitigate that action.
And you got 30 seconds.
Okay, well, I would say in 30 seconds that the other two running backs played well in his absence.
Absolutely.
You know, I think that Washington did a great job, and he looked like baby Marshawn in there taking on hits. You know, after he got hit on that first and goal from the 4-yard line, he actually got hit twice and still had enough strength to keep his feet and go into the end zone. And Jalen Richard is Jalen Richard. They got to step up. We might be using Alawale. Our fullback would take those runs up the middle.
Let's roll it.
So we'll do that.
We'll be back.
We'll be right back, and we'll finish more. I'm getting the signal with your Raider show here on our TV.
We're bringing back Fireworks Night. It gives the fans a chance to get on the field. And isn't that everyone's dream?
It's my honor to present to you the key to the city of Oakland.
Thank you, Mayor.
Okay, boys, let's do this.
Yep, that's what everybody dreams of, a chance to get on the field.
And welcome back to your Raider show on RTV. We got this final segment to talk about what's coming up next in Buffalo. And that's why I say, you know, you found out that Marshawn's not going to play, which I think is going to hurt us, but that just opens the door. Who did you say we should bring on? And I love your thought on that.
And for Marshawn?
Yes.
Well, I think we need to go with our backs. Our backs.
You talked about him. Yes.
Yeah, the fullback. I mean,
you got to play him, man.
He's got a lot of speed. He's a bigger back. If we need somebody to bang up the middle and run between the tackles, not that Jalen Richard or DeAndre Washington is incapable because they're diminutive, but they can run between the tackles.
But I'm just talking about a different look.
A bigger back,
yep.
A pounder.
And that makes theirs even better.
Absolutely. So we can make the adjustment. So do we really need Marshawn? Well, I'm thinking.
Whoa.
Yes, we do.
We need him.
When it gets time and we're
especially when
that
he's playing good
push,
football and our offensive line is blocking.
And we have not seen the best of Marshawn Lynch yet by any means.
He will
make an impact this year for the Raiders. He probably will win a couple of games for the Raiders.
I hope
but
so.
But he does got to keep his head.
But
right?
what a better time to do it against the team he played for.
Absolutely.
That was the team that drafted him out of Cal.
And that's the team we got to face this week. That's the Buffalo Bills led by Tyrod Taylor.
Yep.
He's playing pretty okay right now. They squeaked through one out against
and they should have lost that game.
And that was to – who did they play last week?
Was
it Miami?
No, wasn't Miami.
Baltimore.
No, it was Miami.
It was Miami.
Because Baltimore lost to and there's so many games going on. But Baltimore lost as well.
But the Buffalo Bills is who we have to worry about. And Shady McCoy represents a challenge. I watched the game from last year. And they actually had the Raiders' number, but in the second half, Derek Carr put up 28 points. Seth Roberts was big in that game.
Yep.
But Shady McCoy ran for about 140 yards against
us. Yeah, he did.
And he also caught the ball well. It was here.
Yep.
But we did beat Buffalo the last few times that we played against them. Their defense looks to be near the bottom against the pass, which plays right into our hands.
That's
we need to throw the ball down the field so that we can score a lot of points because they are at home. You know, and they do have a formidable defense. But if our offensive line does what they've been doing, I have no problem. And Derek Carr, you haven't even seen the best of him this year.
No.
He's just getting warm.
Well, the offensive line was the key. And, you know, having Donald Penn come in late and get in sync. Because what people don't understand, no matter how good they are, if they're not in sync with each other like they were last year before Carr got hurt, if I'm next to you, I know everything you think and what you do, what your tendencies are. All of a sudden, you in preseason, you in preseason games and stuff, and he ain't there?
Right, right.
I mean, it just is what it is.
Right.
And people that really don't understand how that goes as a team sport, and it's funny, especially football more than any other sport, because you got so many different areas. You got the offensive line, the defensive line, the linebackers, the backs, the quarterbacks, the ends, the wide receivers, your secondary, your special teams. I mean, I could keep going.
Real quick, two unsung heroes that I think we need to talk about. Denico Autry has been playing very well in a role in that rotation, coming in for Jelly or coming in for Vanderdoes.
Yes, yeah.
Mario Edwards, that's pretty good rotation going on. And on offense, we mustn't forget Vidal Alexander, who stepped in for Newhouse at the right tackle position.
Played really
he
well.
He did a great job holding off Houston. Houston didn't get nowhere near. You didn't even hear Houston's name called the whole night. So the Raiders, they have to continue to next man up and next game up, and we have to take it one game at a time. Let's get this win at Buffalo, stack some wins together. Then we go down to Miami that doesn't have their starting quarterback.
Yeah,
Jay Cutler's gone with
fractured
ribs.
Although Moore is gone, he's better than Cutler to me with that team. Because he's always stepped in.
Yeah, then we get a bye, and then we go to Mexico City to face Tom Brady and the New England Patriots, which is a very pivotal game.
Yeah.
Right, so we're going to get out of here now, and we appreciate you enjoying the Raiders show. And, you know, if you guys got any questions, you can contact us through Facebook/OurTV, and we can take your information, and we can address those questions or concerns or issues that you want to talk about the Raiders on our next show. So, John, why don't you take us out this time?
Well, I'm going to take you out by saying, go Raiders in Buffalo, and we got decent weather. It's not cold. And if you're going to Buffalo, you can't have it any other way. We'll see you next week, RTV, on your Raider show. How's that? Did I do it backwards?
But you did it.